All right, guys, we'll wait a minute here to get some viewers in and stuff. I had an earlier live stream today where I was just talking about Secret Wars 2, the crossovers, and then at the end of it where people were like on the chat and stuff, it started going elsewhere. And I got a phone call and had to go, or a message and had to go and had a little company kind of sorted and stuff like that. So now I'm back on this Sunday. And, you know, it's the month of October. And October means Halloween. And even though Halloween is on the 31st, for me, the whole month should be October. And actually, I was going to do like a series of videos and stuff talking about horror movies and stuff. But man, those are kind of like Dime a Dungeon. Getting into the mood for Halloween. Kind of dime a dozen, man. There's plenty of review shows. There's plenty of, you know, other channels that regularly, you know, talk about movies and horror movies and reviews and stuff. So, you know, I figured I'll just do a live stream and do this for fun and stuff. So I'm surrounded by movies. I don't think we'll get through all of them. These. So yeah, kind of a horror net over here. Get settled back in here. And I figured we'll just go through some movies, talk about them. I'm going to get the chat up on my phone. I'm going to plug my computer back up. Don't go anywhere. We do not want the stream to die in the middle because the battery went dead. All right. Ugh. It's live, folks. Shit happens. But anyway, got all these movies and stuff, VHS. Now, me with horror was kind of interesting, man, because when I was a kid, I'm going to be getting the chat up and hopefully the... We won't lag here, but we'll get the chat up here. But anyway, when I was a kid and stuff, we just got Showtime. And it was really bizarre because I could sit there and get up in the morning and they would actually show The Omen, Salem's Lot, some of these old 70s really evil movies and stuff early in the morning and stuff. And I'd watch them kind of be all right. Yet, there was a movie called, a TV movie called the Bad Ronald that I would watch. And it was based on a book, and it was just like an ABC hour special from the early 70s, and they showed every year and everything like that. And basically, it was about a kid who accidentally killed a girl, and his mom put him in the bathroom. They built a fake wall over the door. The mom died, and this family moved in, and he fell in love with this girl and got chalk and turned the whole bathroom like into some fantasy land where he's going to bring his princess and stuff, and it freaked me out, man, of all things. Things like that. Then there was like The Babysitter, where I think the urban legend came from, and turned around, and that was basically about a girl babysitting, and the phone kept calling, you know, ringing and ringing, and it was a guy stalking and kept trying to tell her to go check the baby, and finally the police called and said the phone calls were coming from inside the house, and she ran outside, and the killer was upstairs in the baby's room waiting for her to come up. It's up until when I was married, I had a split level ranch house and stuff that we had bought and stuff. And even, you know, to that day, to this day, if I'm in a split level house and it's night and I hear the phone ring, people who have landlines, I'm still kind of like, oh no, oh no. All right. So anyway, the Halloween movies and stuff in the month of Halloween, like I said before, the people that's now joining us, we're starting to get some people here. But to me, the whole month of Halloween is fantastic. I like it better than Christmas. I always have, always dressed up. Always trying to find a Halloween party. And of course, it's Rocky Horror Picture Show month, as far as I'm concerned. Okay, Halloween horror movie live chat. This worked earlier today. So, you know, if you got questions or comments or stuff, I'll be checking in routinely. And, like I said, just a lazy Sunday and doing this for fun, guys. All right, let's see if I can get me to come up. All right, guys. All right, we're already getting some viewers coming in. We can probably get started and stuff. Now, I'll kind of categorize this stuff, man, because one of the... I'm going to lose viewers because I'm trying to get this shit going. Halloween. Horror movie live show. Spell check's fucking me up. All right, here we go. Here we go. See if we can get him up here with the... Yes, there we go. Now I am on. I can see the chat. We can get started. And I really hope Halloween is also your favorite thing there. All right, I got the chat up. People are already here. All right, I wish I could see who you are. All right, guys, here we go with the movies and stuff. Now, I kind of got them categorized and stuff. I got VHS and other movies here, and this is not all of it. We'll see what we get through here and stuff, but, you know, maybe we can cover from the classic Universal stuff to today and stuff. And what do you say we start with? How do you guys feel about Ghost? All right. Now, Poltergeist, Steven Spielberg, Stephen King, you know, got up here. This is like 1982 and everything like that. And this was the movie there for a while back in the day. This thing was in the theaters and people saw it. And then people, this thing was all over TV all the time. And then it kind of got like its own mystique about it, because as they did the sequels, the little girl died in it and stuff. But basically it's the, they built the house, you know, on top of an old Indian burial ground. We moved the bodies. No, we didn't. And we have the medium, you know, the exorcist slash medium coming in to try to save the little girl who had been kidnapped by ghosts, and all kinds of little Easter eggs in this and stuff. Just a really great horror movie, man. And there was nothing like the family feeling real. This is one of the things where what made this great is that they felt like real people. This was not like your prim and proper family and stuff like that. They flipped people off and they argued back and forth with each other. Felt pretty good, man. I mean, it was a great movie. And it's still one of my favorite, and I still think it kind of holds up, but it is of its era, you know, so you're going back. Good stuff there, man, all right? And then I'm putting in this. This is a sci-fi movie, but if you know anything about this movie, a lot of people try to say that this movie is about something else, you know, it's subtly about rape and stuff, but it's Alien, right? We came out of Star Wars, and Ridley Scott comes out, and he's like, well, I want to, you know, kind of jump on that a little bit stuff, but the greatest thing about this is that it's really a movie about a haunted house. The ship is the haunted house. The alien is the ghost, you know, so it's technically a ghost story. I mean, it was a freaking awesome movie. And when James Cameron came on and did the second Aliens 2 movie, you know, years later and stuff, I went and watched it and loved it, man, but, you know, completely different. It was straight out sci-fi with space marines. Bill Paxton, you know, kind of stole the movie with his flipping out. You know, they mostly come out at night. Mostly. So they still kind of kept a little, I always feel like that line went back to like a horror movie and stuff, like ghosts come out at night, you know, more ghosts, more aliens and everything like that. But this movie is a freaking classic. John Hurt has the classic scene in it, the ghost, the alien busting out of him, in space, no one can hear you scream, all that stuff, man. Great stuff. Great stuff. Check the chat. Everybody's hanging in there. Ah, okay. I love movies. Sleepy Hollow, Great Pumpkin were my favorite part of Halloween. Yeah, I got some of those. Okay. And going on with more ghosts and stuff, you got The Sixth Sense. M. Night Shyamalan, you know, I guess was his first movie. Before that, he was scripting stuff like Stuart Little and stuff. And then I put him up there with like Hitchcock and stuff, man, the way he always has the twist at the end of his movies. And The Sixth Sense coming in there, man, it was just a very visceral, you know, movie. And you really felt for this kid and the torture of the little kid being able to see dead people and the tagline in it, you know, great performances. Then it has the twist at the ending. And when you realize there's a twist, you figure it out immediately. And the whole movie rushes back and you're like, you mean the whole time this was? And then the magic of it is you can go back and you can watch it twice, you know, and it's a completely different movie the second time around. And the trick to watching this movie, which is just fantastic storytelling through a movie in that medium, is the color red. You always need to be aware of when the color red is around. And that's like your visual clue of what's going on in the movie, if you ever caught that. And yes, M. Night Shyamalan kind of got into a corner of how his movies were made, because everybody started expecting some great big huge twist in all his movies. All right, let me answer this. You know, I don't hear from a lot of people and I don't usually get that much company, but I think it's kind of funny that all this starts happening when I'm, you know, doing the live stream. Okay. And that was a really good one, man. There's some other things here, but one of my favorite movies of all time, like top three movies of all time, you know, we're talking like Pulp Fiction and It's just some movies that I hold near and dear and stuff like that. And the remake of the 1970s Invasion of the Body Snatchers, right? Okay, sci-fi, but basically it's also very horror driven and stuff, right? The whole idea of the people you know around you, all of a sudden they're not who you think they are, and they look like them, and they're acting inhuman and emotionless and stuff, and you really feel more and more isolated, and you're grasping to reach out and find other people who are still human and will believe you. What's going on? The whole paranoia. When the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers came out, it was a political statement, during the 50s and stuff. They have a few nods to it and stuff. But the great thing about this movie that makes it work in the end is the fact that, the first part of the movie, they're showing you what it is to be human, being excited about cooking and having family and friends and being involved with everybody and stuff. And God, Donald Sutherland plays a health inspector. He goes into a restaurant and he's inspecting the food and he pulls out what he calls a rat turd. And then the people who have worked at the restaurant are like, it's a caper. He's like, no, rat turd. And they send it off to get tested, but they've never said what it was. And that was like symbolic and a little bit of foreshadowing of, is it a person or is it a body snatcher? Is it the alien or is it the person? Because they look just alike. Leonard Nimoy, Donald Sutherland, Jeff Goldblum. I mean, this movie holds up. This is one of my favorite movies. And there for a while with my friends, I'll tell when they find out I love this movie, it'll always pop up on some midnight showing on a local station. And I would get phone calls and texts, a couple times a month and stuff because they were showing this at midnight and stuff. I always knew when this was on for a long time. So it's kind of cool to be thought of and be associated with that movie. One of my favorite movies of all time. Never gets old. Let's check the chat. Oh, no, people are sticking in there. I'm freaking awesome. This is awesome. All right, so then the zombies. We'll move on to zombies and stuff. Hopefully we're not moving too far ahead. Zombies can be fun, okay? Can be awesome fun. And one of the first zombie movies I ever saw, the zombies really freaked me out to begin with, right? It's probably the only movies that legitimately kind of freaked me out, and it wasn't because of the flesh eating and the numbers and, the grotesqueness of walking corpses and stuff. It's because in my mind, if there was ever any movie monster or, anything, any ghoul beast, psycho, anything like that could ever come true, for some reason in my mind, it was the zombies. For some reason, I can picture the virus or something, or the government doing something stupid to where, like, the dead really becomes reanimated. Let's have the perfect soldiers are already dead. I mean, for some reason, irrational. It's irrational, I know. Irrational, I know, but there's just something about it. And I saw two or three Italian zombie movies back in the day where they used oatmeal and stuff. It was too real. There was something about those Italian movies that freaked me out. I couldn't even look at famous monster magazines and stuff and be all right with it and stuff. So the zombies, those are the ones that freaked me out. They always freaked me out and stuff. So when the zombie movement hit with the remake of Dawn of the Dead and stuff like that, I had to force myself to go to, like, just get over this. Like, don't be a pussy, Tim. Don't be a pussy. Do it. Go see it. But basically, here's George Romero's Dawn of the Dead from 1978. And this is a freaking classic, man. And what I loved about this, and also kind of pissed me off, is that, of course, it's really talking about, people really holding, we're nothing, as consumers, we're sheep, is what this is saying. There's some social commentary. George Romero always has something to say, with social commentary in his horror movies. Those are some of the best ones when they're really talking about something else, political, social, a statement about people in general and stuff. And it takes place in a mall, and the mall has a gun shop and stuff. Well, I got to watch this with some commentary, and I didn't buy it because I already got the VHS. But I should have got him stuff. But while they're doing the commentary, somebody that was doing commentary on the movie, they got to the part where they found the guns in the gun shop in the mall. And they said right there, you know, they were like right there, this should have told you that this was, you know, impossible. This should have took you out of the movie, because what kind of redneck town would have a gun shop in the mall? Well, sir, I'm going to sit here and correct you, because in the hometown I'm from, there is a gun shop in the mall, and it has been there for over 20 years. So, you know, I was sort of like, well, fuck you, you know, so, you know, well, there you go. But this is such a freaking classic, man. You watch this, you got to go take a shower after it's over with, man. It kind of like just makes you feel, ooh, you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, good stuff. Now, this movie, I cannot believe I did not see in the 80s. I probably found it back 6 years ago. I'm late. I really wasn't too much into horror movies back in the day when I was a younger kid. I thought they were kind of stupid, and it was just how much blood can you get. And as I got older, I started realizing that a lot of this stuff is really comedy. When I got older, I watched a few and I caught myself chuckling. It's like black comedy. It's like, so it's supposed to be ridiculous. The more blood, the funnier it is. And I'm sitting here like, what's wrong with me? And then I had friends who were really, really into horror movie, man. Like they lived it in their daily life. They wore all the black and it was there. And, you know, they could even sit there and tell you what companies made these horror movies, why they were the best, who these directors were, and who were the companies putting out the VHS tapes and stuff for the movie stuff. They really got into it. And I still cannot believe I never saw this in the 80s when it came out. I think this came out in 84, but that doesn't sound right. Well, the DVD came out in 2007, but, you know, dead smack right in the middle of the 80s. We had Return of the Living Dead. We got everything that makes it schlock. We got a military, secret military base. We've got punk rockers running around, you know, just being stupid and drinking and taking off their shirt. And we got this weird fog coming in. And then all of a sudden you got the zombies popping up. These zombies can talk. And whoever made the original Dawn of the Dead with George Romero, they had like a split. You know, they had a legal split. And this guy, you know, Romero got to keep, I think, the word zombie. And this guy, whoever made this, got to keep the Living Dead. So this was his movie. And this thing has parts in it that it's just freaking hilarious, man. These cops show up, think that they're going to save the day. The zombies get him and eat him. And all of a sudden, one of the zombies gets on the CB, and he's like sitting there like, send more cops. And this is where they're saying brains, brains. And this, oh, my God. This thing was hilarious when I watched it, man. I ended up watching it like 5 or 6 times in the first 2-3 months that I finally bought this thing. So it's a fantastic movie. I mean, this is the one I cannot recommend enough. This should be, I don't know, tell you if it's scary or funny, but it's just hilarious. And it's not supposed to be. I mean, it's just so freaking funny. Let's check the chat. Oh, such good stuff. Woo, man, it took off. Okay, my chat just caught up with everybody. Horror Express, SJWs. I don't know what that's about. Color Red, Cold Temperature, Sixth Sense. Yeah, the Color Red. Okay, I got it. Loved both Aliens and the Aliens. Bruce was dead until the end of Sixth Sense. Didn't see it coming. Okay, they're talking about it. Okay. And yeah, the movie's 16, 17 years old, so probably already knows it and stuff, right? Great stuff. All right, guys. So then we got Zack Snyder's remake of Dawn of the Dead. I'm just going down the list here and stuff like that. And this was a fantastic movie. I enjoyed it, man. It kind of really harkened back to the original, you know, without any apologies and stuff. Just a great movie and stuff. They had moments where you felt bad for people, and Ving Rhames was awesome in it and stuff. And they even had this, they just had to slip in a little boob in there and stuff, I guess. And then, like, when the baby zombie popped up, the lady got bit by a zombie. The husband, like, kept her tied up away from everybody because he was going to have the baby, and the baby came out as a zombie. And all of a sudden, they just cut away, and you see the flash of a gun. I shouldn't have been laughing that hard, man, but this is what horror does. You know, I'm like, you know, it kind of gives us a minute to let our dark side out, I guess. And if you can laugh at your dark side, I guess you're in good shape, you know, let's face it, you know. But I like this. The unrated version was fantastic, man. Some of the stuff made me laugh. Some of it had you going, oh, shit. And just a fantastic evening at it and stuff, you know. Then they had a song in it that cracked me up. It sounded like Frank Sinatra was singing. It was very Rat Pack-like, come on and feel the sickness or something. Cracked me up. All right, never watched this one, but this is Night of the Living Dead. I heard this one is terrible. But let's face it, man, there are people out there, their whole goal in life is to get every freaking B-movie and bad horror film, and that's what they want to watch. They go on Netflix. They don't want the 3, 4, and 5-star movies. They want the 1 and 1.5, you know. And I've seen people who love that stuff, this mystery science theater stuff that should be who should be watching. And it's just a goldmine for badness and stuff like that. Yeah, the worse the movie, the more, you know, what else can you say about it stuff, okay? And then I got a few, I thought I had more, man, but I got a few werewolf movies. Now, werewolves have always fascinated me. Maybe it's where I'm in the mountains and stuff. You know, we got coyotes around here and stuff like that. But, one of the very first horror movies I remember really sitting down and just watching was The Howling. I thought this movie is fantastic, and I still think it's fantastic. It's by Joe Dante, who ended up doing, like, Gremlins and The Burbs. I love Joe Dante movies and stuff. He's got that thing where he's kind of like Spielberg, but he's got a little bit of a darkness to him and stuff that just makes you laugh also. But this took the whole concept of werewolves being like a pack. You know, it's this little town, and it kind of carries over. And I remember this movie influencing a game, a role-playing game in the 90s I played through White Wolf, you know. And you had different classes of werewolves, what blew my mind, and they pulled from all these movies and stuff like this. You know, when you're like, you got the fang, you know, you got Glabro and all this stuff. I can't remember. This is a horror movie game. But anyway, this movie just like freaking killed me and stuff, man. And there's little things in there where they were on a budget, and it cracked me up on how they fixed a few things. Like they had a girl seduce a guy around the campfire, and they had the girl turn it into a werewolf while, you know, they were, you know, being naughty. And what they did is they animated it in like a silhouette, and you could tell it was like bad animation. It didn't really take you out of the movie. It had a certain kind of charm on it. And that's what I like about horror movies, with the special effects that come up with, like the bubbling of the head and everything like that. Some of the stuff they do, they try to get innovative. They can't do it. They just go for it. Like, that'll work. Throw it out there. We're going to get it out there. But Howling, maybe it's nostalgia, maybe not, but I think it's one of my favorite, werewolf movies ever. But the sequels, my god, they got worse and worse, and they were all a little fun on their own and stuff. All right, guys, let's check the chat here, man. We're getting some more people in. I'm glad y'all are sticking around, man. Whoa, okay. Return to Oz may not be horror, but it's got a pumpkin-headed character and one of the most disturbed movie monsters I remember as a kid, the Willers. Great Halloween movie. All right, I think that's Red Vitamin Blue. I think I recognize that avatar. I had that movie on VHS, and you talk about terrifying some kids. Oh, got a little lag. Talk about terrifying some kids. Yeah, it was right there. The Mall is going to be the name of my next band. That is Jared. All right, I'll be looking for that. Okay, cool. Good stuff. Let's keep it going here. All right. And then you've got what I think is just a crown jewel for horror across the board and stuff, man. The special effects might have won an Academy Award or something, like that, but it's really innovative, 1981. To me, when it comes to special effects, to me, this is the Star Wars of horror, you know, what you're saying. This is the one where they finally showed somebody actually transforming into a werewolf without showing the stop animation. The head is bubbling. You see the hairs grown out. They're screaming. You hear the bones cracking. You see their hands turn into paws. And they just, you know, jump up there. And they're like howling. And you just see it. This is such a long take from... I got the classic horror movies over here from the first werewolf movie. It seems like I had more here, man. But anyway, I've got more werewolf movies and stuff. I just grabbed these real quick. But, you know, it's an American werewolf in London. And it's just so fantastic, man. Just two hikers. Going through, I think it was England, Scotland or something. Oh my, yeah, well in London, it's in Great Britain. And you're right there with them, you know, it's a long shot of them running in the dark. They think they're hearing things. They end up in a weird pub where they look up and they see satanic symbols that are actually for protection and stuff. And the people let them go and they end up, you know, one gets killed and one gets bitten and starts having weird dreams, wakes up in a hospital, meets a girl. And, you know, the wolf is taking him over. I mean, this is so good. This is a freaking classic. And if you took it out of the horror genre, you know, oh, I'm getting all pumped up looking at this stuff. Good, good stuff. So where are we at now? All right. It's lighting the mood up a little bit. Let's lighten the mood up, man. There's some fun stuff that's for Halloween, you know. We'll go back to the horror here in a minute. Well, let's go through this stack of stuff. Can you see me? All right. Okay, you got stuff that's just fun. Sit down with the family, sort of, and let's all watch and stuff, man. And, you know, we know Ghostbusters. It's a freaking classic, man. The Ghost, the Slime, Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Harold Ramis, Sigourney Weaver, Ernie, what's his name? It's right on the tip of my tongue. Oh, he didn't even make the box, man. Anyway, but there's four of them. Ghostbusters, man, came out of nowhere, and it became a huge phenomenon. Had a rabid fan base and stuff. Slimer, cartoons, toys. Ghostbusters 2, if you're a fan, maybe you liked it, maybe not. I'm not going to comment on the one that just came out. And then you had the real Ghostbusters 3 sequel, which was the video game that came out a few years ago. I'm sure you can get online and find all that stuff. All right. Now, this was one that I saw at a drive-in when I was a kid, man. And there's all sorts of little jokes in there and stuff, man. But this is a funny horror movie. Love at First Bite, with George Hamilton playing Dracula as his Reinfeld or whatever it was, little bug-eating dude and stuff. Like, and this was so freaking funny. They got the man in Hollywood at the time with the greatest tan to come out and play Dracula. And this thing is so freaking funny and just awesome. Everybody in it is so cool. And it's got disco. It's got a little disco in there. And, you know, not bad. He gets run out of Transylvania, and he ends up in New York, and it's so funny how he gets there, and then he falls in love. He goes out and eats in New York the first night and gets, you know, bites a wino and feels like hell the next morning with a hangover. Just all kinds of real funny stuff, man. So freaking good. And then you have a psychiatrist. He falls in love with this New York model, and she has a psychiatrist that has fallen in love with her, and it just turns out that he is, I think he's a descendant of Van Helsing, the vampire hunter. So, you know, just funny stuff. Then you got one, the National Lampoon High School Reunion. And this is freaking hilarious with a serial killer in it and stuff. You know, it's so funny, man. These are people who brought you Animal House and stuff and everything like that. But you know, there's a high school reunion in the abandoned high school, and there's a killer loose killing everybody. And you get the flashbacks and stories of what they did to them. And yeah, I don't blame them for wanting to kill them, you know. But there's, you know, of course, it's like the early 80s, so it's pot smoking and innuendo and things like that hidden in there. I think I got the DVD of this somewhere too, so I'll probably pop up with it, man. But Monster Squad, man. Okay, they said this thing failed in the movies. I love the movie. And then when it came time to be able to go get this as a rental, you could hardly ever find it, man. This thing was constantly checked out, man. This was, you know, everybody get together, spend the night or whatever, or get bored and let's go get a movie. And grab Monster Squad, man. Bring back the Universal monsters in here all together, and it's a bunch of little kids that, like, you know, stepped out of the Goonies. You know, it's up to them to stop them, you know. And what I loved is that it's got the creature from the Black Lagoon in it. It's got Dracula, Mummy, and they're all changed just enough to where they don't get sued. Oh, so freaking good, man. Oh my gosh. Ugh. And we're probably going to watch that after this stream. Fantastic movie. All right. And then, you know, we keep going back to England and stuff. Well, looky there. There's my Monster Squad on DVD. All right. We got Shaun of the Dead, you know, going back to the zombies and stuff. This thing is brilliant. Brilliant, right? And then they have the Queen song, Faster Than the Speed of Light. Is that what it's called? Can't remember what it's called. Don't Stop Me Now. That's it. Don't Stop Me Now in it, and pull tables and bars. And it's just, you know, and of course, it's got social commentary in it. It's just a fantastic movie. And George Romero liked this so much that they let some of the cast in here, Simon Powell. What is wrong with me? Simon Pegg and a few of them. They were in Land of the Dead, chained to a wall with zombies and stuff. They had a cameo in there because of this movie. And this movie was freaking hilarious. Oh, my God. So good. So good. All right. And a lot of people are going to sneer at this one and stuff because, you know, we've got we got some people with their channels who are big Dark Shadows fans, Hippies Collectibles, Great Legend and stuff. They're all stuff like that. But we have Johnny Depp and Tim Burton sitting here doing their Dark Shadows with Eva Green, Johnny Depp, and all this stuff. I can make it through the first half of the movie, and then something happens that the last half of this thing just falls apart, and I'm just like, it's unwatchable. But it's just so funny still to kind of watch it and stuff. And then we have the classic, the TV show, the 30s comic strip that it was, and great movies that they had and stuff. The Addams Family. Everybody knows the song. Everybody knows, you know, all the characters in Lurch, you rang, and it's all in there. Uncle Fester, Gomez, Wednesday, Pugsley, Grandma, right? And I got the sequel here somewhere and stuff, but fantastic, fantastic movie. Just so freaking good. They captured everything in it. Nothing like a family that you can feel really loves each other, and they could probably kill you in the same breath and be like, I did it because I love you, you know. Okay, check the chat. Oh, come on and upload. Yes, Zack Snyder did do a good movie, guys, with that Dawn of the Dead. Ernie Hudson. Ernie Hudson was the fourth Ghostbuster. Now we're working together. That's what we need. Oh, I can't find Return of Oz on DVD. I don't know if it's out there. I have the VHS that I found at a yard sale, my friend. A yard sale. Okay, they're already answering you. Horror movie live show. Well, thanks for being there. What was the horror Leslie Nielsen do? I don't know. He did one with Mel Brooks called Dracula Dead and Loving It, if you want to call that a horror movie, you know. But anyway, Cabin in the Woods, right? Okay, this was fantastic, man. This kind of draws from every B-movie and mainstream and any horror movie and stuff, and they explain how kids in these horror movies can be out in a cabin in the woods or in a house, and they got somebody, something or somebody trying to kill them. And while there's always a magic, you know, seems like there's sometimes there's just this magic item that brings the curse. You know, it just explains why you have the archetypes, you know, like the burnout, the athlete, the prom queen, the weirdo, things like that. And why they do stupid shit in these movies, horror movies, you know, and they bring it together so well. Now, anybody that knows how this movie ends, because I started watching this anime called, or anime, or whatever it is, manga comic, series, and I watched the Japanese movie that they made of Attack on Titan, and for some reason I feel like the end of this movie led to Attack on Titan, and it fits. It really does. This movie is so freaking fantastic if you're into the, and it's really light and it's funny, even though it's got horror qualities in it and stuff like that. But basically, you know, you feel like Shaggy is the only one that knows what the hell is going on, and nobody listened to the burnout and stuff, man. But, oh, I ended up liking it. And I'm not usually a Joss Whedon fan. I mean, I don't hate Joss Whedon. I get what he does, and a lot of people love what he does and everything like that. But to me, I was like, well played, Joss. Well played. You know, you made me buy the thing. Got it out of bargain bin, but you made me buy it. And I like putting this in every now and then and stuff, and, you know, trying to pick out all the monsters that they're satiring and stuff from these movies, you know. Great, great stuff. And then the classic. I don't know if I have to say too much about this. Young Frankenstein. Yes, Young Frankenstein. Probably one of the greatest comedies ever. And they actually used the actual props and stuff from the original Frankenstein movie of the 30s and stuff, right? It's his descendant. And it's got so many classic lines and classic bits and stuff in it. Check this. Wow. Okay, I'm going to check the chat again. We want to move on to some horror now and stuff. You know, we got some light stuff. We'll try to mix it up here in a little bit and stuff. All right. There it goes. I hated Cabin in the Woods the first time I seen it, but it's grown on me over time. That's a lot. That's me with a lot of Joss Whedon stuff, right? I think I recognize that Avatar, Count Von Strange the Fourth and stuff, all right? So, yeah, awesome, man. Thanks for sticking around, man. We're starting to get more people in. For you guys that are just now joining the stream, make sure I keep the chat up here, man. We've gone through some horror movies. I've gone through some lighter stuff for the family. We're going to get back to the Dead Set Horror. And for you guys, I hope some of you guys like the Rob Zombie movies, okay? Because Rob Zombie movies work on two levels, right? Rob Zombie is pulling in there from, you know, what he thinks horror is and his vision of it and the beards. He's so in a bubble, being fascinated with the 70s, with the fashion and the music and the looks and stuff. And, you know, I kind of got that because I remember it as a kid, you know, stuff, you know, how it was a quieter time, more primitive time. And you can make great horror movies in that time because you don't have to explain cell phones and internet and a whole lot of other stuff. It was a more primitive time where you were lucky to find a CB or a payphone if you're out in the middle of anywhere. You know, and, you know, I think I can do these in orders here. So the first, the movie that he came out with that I went and saw in the theater that I was, you know, really excited about was House of a Thousand Corpses. I think he made this movie and it didn't come out to about two, it didn't get distributed 2-3 years later. And this movie is a mess, but you had to go in realizing what Rob Zombie is doing. I think he had the mindset, if I remember right, and this was around the time Lord of the Rings came out. Okay. I remember seeing Lord of the Rings and this around the same time. That's gotta be right. But anyway, it's got like, you know, but the second way they work on is, and this is what I'm saying, when you go see some Rob Zombie movies, he probably thought this he would never get to make another movie. So he threw everything in that he loved in this. So it is a hot mess. You have Texas Chainsaw Massacre in this. You got Dr. Satan in this. You got Creature from the Black Lagoon written on a wall. All right. You got talk of Marilyn Monroe versus Betty Page. You know, you've got like, you know, like I said, the Psycho Texas Chainsaw family and stuff. So this thing is really a hot mess because he was throwing everything he loved about his brand of horror. And I saw some TV show or something one time where he was getting interviewed and they were actually in his house and you went in and he had this whole room where it was nothing but shelves and shelves and shelves of VHS and some DVDs or something of horror movies, just hundreds of them. And if you're into the Ramones, Johnny Ramone and the Ramones were into sci-fi and horror movies. And that's how Rob Zombie and Johnny Ramone ended up being friends because they had these huge horror movie collections. And even Rob Zombie and his music would turn around and you could hear him sampling some stuff from these horror movies he would watch. You know, we're talking the Grindhouse Drive-In, evil shit and stuff like that. You know, you would hear like a druids or witches chanting in some of his music and stuff that he put out there and stuff. So this was really cool. So all of a sudden, you know, he made some money with this and he pulled in like 70 stars and characters and stuff from the TV show. This has got Sid Haig in. If you don't know who Sid Haig is, you need to look him up. So anyway, but then all of a sudden he got to make a real movie. And to me, this is his masterpiece. Okay. This is The Devil's Rejects, man. I got off work early. I requested to get off work early about 2 weeks before this came out and hauled my ass to a theater 45 minutes away to see The Devil's Rejects, and it was freaking awesome. This is a film. This has something to say. This will have you walking away feeling like you need to take a shower and the freaking thing's going to haunt you, because they take the Texas Chainsaw Massacre family, more or less is what they are, the killers family, and all of a sudden they make them human and you're kind of feeling for them. By the end of it, you're kind of cheering the psychos, the serial killers, the people they're being cruel with. That's what he's done. You're in this and the police are after him and they're doing terrible things to terrible people. And then all of a sudden by the end of it, man, Freebird comes on and you're having this Bonnie and Clyde moment where they're all going to die and you're feeling for him. I still don't know how he did that, but it was genius. And yeah, I'm shocked myself saying it out loud, but I love this movie. So good. So good. So good. All right. And then he ended up doing Halloween. He did a remake of Halloween. Now, I have Halloween, the original one by John Carpenter, and that was the game changer, right? If there's ever a horror movie that people were probably, that are really into the genre, would say you need to wait till last to show, it's probably going to be Halloween, all right? Let me check the chat and make sure I'm not going to get buzzed here in a minute. So, Halloween, we're getting ready to talk about Halloween. Halloween, we're coming. People are asking if I'm doing a live show. That's amazing. Somebody's talking out there. Okay. Amazing. There we go. More comments below. I like the first Saw movie, and the second was okay. Hey, brother, this is my favorite movies. The host from Talking Dead is in that movie. I love the Universal Monsters. Okay. So the Halloween movies came out, and Michael Myers was the one that apparently changed the game, right? It's got the classic piano music and stuff, which is what made the movie come together. You've got, like, Michael Myers, who's like a supernatural killer. And there's things about it that that was the mystique of Michael Myers, is that he really seemed like some kind of embodiment of a supernatural force. You just didn't know what. The movie really freaked me out when I can't remember if it was the police or the psychiatrist pulls outside of the asylum because they hear about a break-in, you know, somebody's escaping. They know it's Michael. And all of a sudden, you just see this figure come out of the dark, and he's got like the, the hospital robe on where you can see his ass in the back. He doesn't go around him. He goes straight for him, and you hear them pop, 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 jumping on the car and keeps running into the night. That really freaked me out the way they did it. But that music, man, that beautiful piece of music, that used to be my ringtone, and I had to change it because it was freaking people out, man. Okay. So with that said, that was part of what made the Halloween franchise come. This is where your Jasons came from, and arguably your Freddy, and all these little psycho movies that were coming out that were, cashing in on that and stuff, revived the horror, if you will. Brought about the Scream Queens back, with Jamie Lee Curtis and stuff like that. And then you get down here and I got the rated and unrated version. And Rob really needed a few scenes he needed to pull back in that unrated one. All right, of Halloween, Rob Zombie is all of a sudden, he's doing it. And it was really cool because what he did with his version of it is it felt like the 70s. And if you're really into both movies, you can intertwine those movies because this is the origin of Michael. And then by the time he gets to the town to find his sister, he answers questions. Where did Michael get his clothes? How did he find the mask? How did he do this? How did he do that? Now, that's a good thing if you're really into Halloween and you kind of like having those things answered. Now, I'm one of those people. I like seeing how, Rob was able to like really be so into these horror movies and try to stay faithful to the character and stuff and still answer these things. And he threw in a few characters who were like in the original Halloween, and an actress that was like a little kid in one of the Halloween movies, Danny something or other. But it kind of takes away from the mystique of the legacy of Michael Myers. When you have all the answers, when you can look behind the curtain and see how everything really works and stuff, kind of like tones it down a little bit. Michael Myers can't be killed, and he's doing this on Halloween, and he's got super strength, and he just shows up with all these resources and stuff like that. Where did he get the mask? Where did he get that? Still a great movie. Doesn't bother me. Fantastic piece of work. It's really odd how some horror movies can actually come off looking like a piece of art. We're talking horror, getting messaged again. Okay. Check in the messages, check in the chat. Okay. What is going on here? There we go. Okay. My chat is now not refreshing, but it will in a minute, guys. So please, keep commenting and stuff, right? What do we have next? We already talked about that. And then speaking of the psychos and stuff coming out of there. Oh, I got one more, man. Lords of Salem. This is where Rob Zombie does the witches. There for a while, there was like this zeitgeist going on. I thought, we had the vampires with, in the 80s. I feel like the vampires were big in the 80s. Before that, you did have some werewolf renaissance and stuff. And then you had like the big psycho killers. And then like since like for 10 years with the Walking Dead, the Talking Dead, all the zombie movies that came out, like turning to be dime a dozen. We've had like zombie mania and stuff. I kind of thought with a few books that came out, Anne Rice, a comic book called Witches, and then with the Lords of Salem coming out, I thought we were going to see the witches resurgence there for a while. They even had an American Horror Story even had a season dedicated to the witches, which cracked me up because Stevie Nicks popped up. If you know anything about Stevie Nicks, she's kind of witchy on stage with her clothes and stuff. What a word, witchy. Too much Eagles. The fucking Eagles. I can't believe I just did that. Anyway, Lords of Salem, I enjoyed, man. Not his greatest movie, but he always fills it up with full of cameos and gives people work in his movies that you're going to recognize as character actors. He likes people with a lot of character in their face or you'll know where they were pulled from in the movies and stuff. He kind of cast the people that he was fans of when he was watching movies and growing up and stuff. But very evil movie. But I want to warn you, if you are not into the horror of the late 60s and 70s, the ending might not be something you like. And I'm not talking like, oh my God, I can't believe he did that to somebody. No, it's kind of got an artsy statement on how it ends and stuff, just to let you know, I was fine with it because I've seen that in movies before with what he did, man. He really dug deep in some of his horror, hit a little bit of the Hammer films and stuff. Okay. And then we're kind of down to the Psychos here, man. Are we hanging in there? I'm getting more and more viewers, guys. So I mean, looks like I might stick around here for a little bit. Dang on. All right, let's go over some of these. Dang on, man. My comments refreshed, man. This is awesome. Okay. Halloween is my favorite series, but I wish they didn't give in and make the whole entire franchise about Michael Myers. He was only meant for movies 1 and 2, and then after that they were going to. See, and that's the thing about horror movies. I'm kind of like a casual fan. The movie I like is the movie I like. And I love when I hear people who are really into their horror or they know a lot about what was going on, what was supposed to be going on. You know, it's kind of nice to be able to sit back and be maybe the one to be able to like take it in. Like, oh, that's interesting. That's cool, man. So, yeah, I mean, there's people who, you know, some of these characters are closer to their hearts, man. Scout Taylor Compton was not so much. Okay. One of the best things about Myers is the fact that he really has no motive for what he does. You don't like the Eagles? Get the hell out of my cab. I'm getting out of Long Beach because I'm a deadbeat. You know, so, yeah, fucking Eagles. Oh, man. In 2010, I went to Lebowski Fest up in Louisville, Kentucky. And the University of Kentucky, or I think it was building a stadium, football stadium up there. And the guy who was running Lebowski Fest looked at me. He's like, you're not going to believe this. And this is happening in my hometown. I'm like, what? He's like, you know what the first thing they're going to be putting in that stadium is? And I'm sitting here thinking, I don't know who the rivals are for Kentucky college football or whatever. And he was like, no, man, the fucking Eagles. Yeah, the Eagles are going to be in Louisville, home of Lebowski Fest. The first band they have here is going in that stadium is going to be the Eagles. I was like, you poor soul. All right, now we're getting some movies that are just kind of disturbing, man, okay? The Shining. The Shining is one of those movies where I'm really sitting here like, do I really need to say anything? Do I really need to say anything? I saw this movie when I was about 8 or 9 years old, and I was able to sit through it, man, but it was mesmerizing, and it had this feeling where I couldn't understand why I was scared. You know, it just had this, I'm looking at weird things, I'm seeing people act really weird, it's got like this fisheye lens feel to it, it was very surreal. There's times where you went from it didn't feel real till it was real, then all of a sudden you see the psycho dad, you know, here's Johnny and all this stuff. And part of the reason I probably was able to not get too disturbed by it was because I liked Clockwork Orange. Okay, to me that was a Kubrick movie. This one, I was just too young to really understand what was going on and stuff, you know. But that's fine. I mean, I knew it was horror and I got all the references and there's a lot of stuff where I'm like, why is it so quiet? And why is he seeing blood and everything like that? Just so fantastic, man. It was like when I watched this, I was like, what? I thought everybody in this damn movie was crazy. So I was really watching people not getting into the story like this is terrifying. But I'm like, what the hell is wrong with them? That was the feeling of this, man. And this is genius. Yeah. This was the movie where I thought this was the weirdest bunch of people. Like they're walking around, there's a man at a bar, and they're just, you know, I'm just like, what? You know, just a whole freaking little world. So I saw this movie a little different than everybody else, you know. And I'm going to admit, I've never read the book The Shining. I've had it in my hands. I want to read Dr. Sleep, the sequel to it and stuff, but really like this movie. And this is the one that has all the conspiracy theories about it. Like, this is Stanley Kubrick admitting that he shot the fake footage for the moon landing in 68. This is him telling us, you know, pick up all the signs, all the signals and stuff. There's a whole documentary with all the theories about what's in the movie to let you know that Kubrick is trying to say, hey, man, I faked the moon landing with NASA. I'm the one who shot the footage. And on that end of it, it's kind of fun to look at movies like that, as long as you know it's for fun. But it just added a whole layer of this. And sometimes that'll make it fun. And sometimes that'll take the integrity away from a movie. But that's part of the cool thing about people dissecting this movie and trying to, you know, say this is what Kubrick's message was. It's right in front of us the whole time, you know. Now, this horror movie, this horror movie, okay, right off the bat, man, this is Eli Roth. Eli Roth pulls from old Hammer films, just like, you know, Rob Zombie kind of does and a few other people and stuff. And, oh, man, I used to know some of the movies he pulled directly from. Oh, God. Anyway, but there's Hammer movies, you know the English horror movies that came out, had a lot of Christopher Reeves and stuff in there, Christopher Lee in them and stuff. And they turned around, and he pulled from some of those movies. So when they say that his stuff is torture porn, he's really going back to, like, Grindhouse movies and stuff and everything that's going on. Took me a while to get them. But this set of some movies, this set of movies that I want to show you here, the reason it really is a horror movie for me is because the way that the guys got baited into being caught and tortured, that would have been me. I mean, I'm watching it, and I'm just sitting there just owning it, nodding my head up and down like, they would have got me. Hook, line, and sinker. You can watch all these other horror movies and be like, get out of the damn house, break the window, get out the window. What the hell are you doing? Pick it up, get up, don't turn around, don't go back. You know, all these stupid things. And all of a sudden, here's a movie where I'm like, I would have took that bait. I'm an idiot. I was stupid. And I'm talking about Hostel. Bunch of guys, tourists, go around backpacking across Europe, or they're just there having a good time looking for girls on vacation or whatever they're doing. And they meet these sexy women, and the women are like having a party, and they're all screwing and stuff. And they're like, hey, we're from this town, man, over in, like, you know, some country I never heard of and stuff. Get on the train. We'll meet you there. There's all kinds of girls like this and stuff. Yeah, in my early 20s, they would have got me. Hook, line, and sinker. And then you are auctioned off to a bunch of rich people. The winner of the auction gets to sit you down in a room and do whatever the hell they want with you. Catch you up, torture you, take a drill to you, whatever they want. You know, and I'm like, they'd have got me. So the first one was, you know, about the group of guys. And the second one was about a group of girls, the sequel. And the sequel kind of shows you a little bit behind the scenes about how your ass gets auctioned as soon as you get to the town and stuff, man. Actually, really good movies. A lot of people put them down. I thought they were fantastic. You want a bad Hostel movie? It's the third one. All right. Oh, sorry, guys. Let's check the comments again. See what's going on here. Get the hell out of my cab. How funny. Wow. Whoa. The way it's refreshing, man. I'm getting like a bunch of them. Okay. The Dude Abides. I watched that yesterday. I visited the Stanley Hotel about 4 years ago, and I got to stick my head through the door like that. It was awesome. Super. Okay. The Stanley Hotel is the hotel that they shot The Shining in. Okay. How much longer will you be on? I'm just going to kind of go until I'm tired. I mean, we're actually halfway through the movie. So if you guys are in, I mean, my viewership's going up. You know, it's sticking around. There's been one or two people pop in and out, but it could be the same people. What bothered me most about the movie was that they treated hedges like they were brick walls. Exactly. That's what I was referring to when I was talking about Hostel. In The Shining, they had the maze of hedges and stuff like that, and nobody would just break through the, you know. I've seen hedges like that, and they're kind of pretty thick, but you can get through them, you know. Yeah, I'm with you. I'm with you on that. Also, it's about the slaughter of Native Americans. I've heard that. Yeah. 227, I think, 227. Isn't that the TV shows? Is he sure that's the right hotel number or room number, I mean? As a kid who spent his youth finding shortcuts through hedges, I don't put their hedge maids scary. Yeah. The Cub was good. Both were excellent. Okay. Oh, okay. All righty. Now I'm going to get into what I call hillbilly horror. All right. You got shows like X-Files, who kind of did some of this stuff first. They had a banned episode where it was a bunch of inbred hillbillies that kept their mom in a box under a bed so they could just, you know, pretty much copulate with her and make more family members. And she was fine with it and all this stuff. There's been all sorts of little things. This isn't the beginning, but these kind of take place in the mountains, the Appalachian Mountains or something like that. Or they've got like a little touch of, you know, the hillbilly and stuff. A lot of stuff, a lot of horror that can come out of it. And let's face it, it goes back to Deliverance, you know, causing I don't want to say a stereotype, man, because there's been some fucked up shit happening in the mountains, but there's been fucked up shit everywhere, right? Now, around here, this was really bad because where I'm kind of living, where I grew up was 45 minutes from the West Virginia state line, 60 minutes from Tazewell or Tennessee line. And now where I'm at now, I think I'm 40 minutes from the North Carolina line, 60 minutes from the Tennessee line, and I'm 20 minutes from the West Virginia line, right? And this movie came out called Wrong Turn. Like I said, I feel like this was taken right from an X-Files episode of the 90s and stuff. I don't know when this came up, man. Who knows? Anyway, but this is the greatest thing about this movie that made it so damn scary. These people get on a dirt road. They have no cell signal. They're out in the middle of the woods. There's things wrong with their car. And it's some, you know, cannibal, inbred hillbillies out there killing them with great hunting skills. They can shoot a bow and an arrow. But the greatest thing about this and why I think the other sequels didn't work is that you never clearly see them. They're a blur over here. And you're just like, did he have a messed up eye? Was he deformed? And that's the whole thing. Every time you saw them, it was like in a blur. So your mind filled in the pieces and you didn't have to look at something that could have been flawed makeup wise and stuff. And great movies, actually, some of the scariest movies don't show the actual violence that they're talking about. Your mind will fill in the gaps for you and scare you than anything they could come up with. I've heard that in a bunch of documentaries or a bunch of interviews and stuff. And I'm like, it's genius. And I'll see, well, that's not common knowledge. But Wrong Turn, man, great movie. Sequels, not so much. Here's one that is just for fun, right? It's got a mummy in it. And it's got Elvis. Bubba Hotep. Eddie Campbell, self of Evil Dead. All right. Eddie Campbell. Damn it. That's a penciler in comic books. Ugh. Bruce Campbell. It's Bruce Campbell. Take two. Bruce Campbell playing a very, very old Elvis, who is fighting Bubba Hotep, the mummy that is crawling around in old folks' home and killing people by eating their soul by sucking it out of their ass. Because nobody is going to be questioning why there's so many dead people coming out of old folks' home. John F. Kennedy is in a wheelchair. He is now black. And they filled the hole in the back of his head with sand. Is it him? You never know. But this is all about Elvis finding out that he didn't die. He switched places with a Elvis impersonator while he lived that guy's life. And he ended up having a barbecue accident where his papers to prove who he was blew up in this trailer he was living in, but he was fine. So he was living the life of an Elvis impersonator after the other fake guy died. And he ended up breaking his hip and didn't have insurance. He didn't have the money as he had his Elvis. So he's been in a retirement home the whole time, unable to walk because he got a broke hip. And now he's old and stuff, and he's thinking about Priscilla. And by God, he's going to get up, and he and JFK are going to take out Bubba Hotep. Great movie. You will be cheering. Another Eli Roth thing takes place in the woods. Maybe it's the mountains. Cabin Fever. Going back to those old 70s movies and stuff like that. This is about a flesh-eating virus. Yep, group of kids, flesh-eating virus, all kinds of things. Great stuff. And a kid who knows kung fu that just yells pancakes. Pancakes. I'm starting to lose everybody. Uh-oh. All right, let's check the comments here. As usual, this thing's going to load. Oh, my gosh. All right, and if anybody's got any movies they want to talk about or something like that, pop them in there, man. I don't know. I might have them here. I don't know. This is just some things I grabbed. Now, let's see if this comments will refresh. There we go. There it is. 237. Got it. Cub movie, my bad. X-Files. First episode, season 3. Elijah Dushku. Yeah, she was in Wrong Turn. Bubba Hotep. We got a fan. What do we got here? The greatest thing about Wrong Turn was Eliza Dushku's tank top. That very well could be. Maybe that tank top should have been like in the credits. It's all on its own. You know, you never know. Anything, Chris? Oh, come on. Makes it a great in the book. Phantasm and John dies in the end. My Phantasm DVDs freaking got stolen. Oh, my God. I finally found them, and I got them at a yard sale believe it or not, all three Phantasm movies. I think there was three. I got all of those for $1 a piece, not 4 years ago. Stolen, gone. I couldn't believe it. I mean, every now and then it seems like some of my shit gets ripped off. I drank beer for 4 years. Okay. Oh, come on, man. I drank beer for Kevin Fever's pretty good. Kind of had the Night of the Living Dead feel to it. Yep. Yep. All right. Let's see if we got any more here. All right. Okay. Oh, there we go. They are remastering the first J.J. Abrams is funding. Are you Phantasm? Okay, gotcha. Thanks, man. I think I heard something about that. I hope it is Phantasm. I know they're making it again. Yeah, appreciate it, man. All right, then we've got a movie that freaks me out, not because of the monsters and stuff that are in it, but basically because of the claustrophobia that's in it. I have been spelunking. We have caves where I grew up that actually go, as far as they know, 20 miles in several directions. It was called Chimney Caves, right? And it was actually behind a Lowe's. And just over the last couple of years, they finally sealed that thing up. So I know how a cave smells. I've been up and down on levels in them and stuff like that. It's so easy to get turned around. The black is the blackest black you'll ever be in and stuff like that. So this movie really freaked me out on that end of it, man. But it's a bunch of women who get together and they're kind of thrill seekers or something like that. And one of them slept with the other one's husband and they know it and stuff. And they still, that's the holy thing. I hope I'm remembering this movie right. But one lady, they're all friends. They're all thrill seekers. But one lady found out about the other lady sleeping with her husband and the dumb bitch still went down into a cave system with her. And then you start finding out that there's things living in there that have adapted. Apparently, a bunch of humans got trapped in these caves generations ago. And since then, they have bred like freaking rats in there. And they've adjusted to the dark and they'll eat raw meat. You know, they're it's not so much that they're cannibals. You know, there's this like tons of bones everywhere. They just kind of grab the deer and dogs jump on it and... So when people get down there every now and then, and some hikers and stuff, they'll get pulled down in there and stuff. And the cave system that they're in, man, the idea of being stuck in the dark with these things that know these caves like the back, they don't need their eyes anymore and stuff. Evolution at its best, man. You know, stay in the cave until we all change and become cave rats and stuff like that. Yeah, some bad stuff, and leave one in there. So when the second one came out, yeah, I'm on top of it, and they apt. Oh my God. There's parts in this movie where I'm feeling the claustrophobia. I'm like, what the hell are you doing and stuff? And you get to see more of the cannibalistic cave people, if you will, and stuff, and some stuff that's going on, man. I'm like, wow, they're pretty well done. This one, you kind of find out that there's one of the characters ended up like being down there for a long damn time surviving and stuff. I'm like, really? You couldn't find your way out? Everybody else did, you know. All right, guys, let's check this one more time while I take a drink. We're going to hit some VHS fun. I say VHS and somebody jumps out of here. Sorry. Okay, come on, refresh. If see, when it refreshes, it takes me all the way to the top. Descent, laugh out loud. The Keep. Oh, God, I haven't watched The Keep since the 80s, if it's the one I'm thinking of, man. Was that like Nazis? Oh, I can't remember. Got any Goosebumps stuff? No, but I know people that do. I heard Goosebumps is really good. I do have some TV shows here to show. My most scariest favorites. That's got to be Comic Book of Steet. Yeah. The Exorcist, Omen, Blair Witch Project. Well, you're in luck. One of those movies will be discussed in a minute if you're sticking around. Okay. Love all those movies, by the way, Esteep. All right. So where are we at here? Where are we at? Okay, now we're going to get into some. Where do we want to start here? Let's just hit these. Oh. Okay, we're going to stick this in there because it's Steets out there. I don't know what he is, but a movie that I liked, but it was because of my brother. I ended up liking it, man. Blair Witch Project, Curse of the Blair Witch. Little documentary here in the Blair Witch. Let me explain how this movie ended up getting you, okay? When this movie came out, they said it was found footage in This is the 90s, okay, dawn of the popular internet that we all could get. Everybody had dial-up. And what they did is that they said this movie is based, the three people disappeared in the woods, and we found this footage years later and stuff, right? So what they did is they used the freaking internet for the first time to fool everybody. They had fake newspapers out there, fake news reports or something. This VHS that goes with this kind of explains some of that and stuff like that. And the thing about Blair Witch is though, is when you got out there, in my mind, I was like, ha ha ha, they're not fooling me. There's no way the families of these people would agree to that. They recreated it with actors. Yeah, even I kind of thought this was a true story. Yeah. I mean, I own it. I wasn't the only one fooled and stuff, right? And it turns out they went out there and they kind of made the script up as they went along. They psychologically fucked with these actors in real life. So to where by the time you're seeing them freak out more and more and more in the movie, it's kind of real. And they have the 2-3 legends of the woods that they tell in this. And when I went to see the theater and all this stuff, I was there. And then I get to the ending, and I'm like, what the hell was that shit? So on the way back, my brother looks at me, and he goes, and this is what I need to fill you in about Blair Witch. There was a legend in there about a guy who grabbed two kids, and he was going to kill them. But he would put one on a table, and he'd make the other one stand in a corner with his head in the corner. At the very end of the movie, you see two of the guys that disappeared, the grown men, years later. You see one has his head in the corner. And my brother said, didn't you see him standing in the corner? That was the child killer. It was never a witch. It was the child killer. Is what in the movie just clicked, and I loved it. Hated, what the hell was that second one? The Book of Dark, Book of Souls, or that was the second one was fucking awful, man. And I just saw the Blair Witch Woods, whatever it was, the Blair Witch. This is the Blair Witch Project. That was the Blair's Witch. Oh, the sequel just came out. I liked it. It was pretty good. So there you go, Steve. Yes. Okay. Good stuff. Blair Witch, I thought was just fantastic. Okay, now we got one. This is inspired by the comics, okay? EC Comics, okay? I think it was Joe Dante. I don't want to be wrong here. George Romero, Stephen King. Seems like Joe Dante was involved in this. I'm probably wrong. George Romero, this is pretty much the ode to EC horror comics from the 50s. Creepshow. 4 or 5 fantastic stories in here inspired by the 50s comics. It's got some animation to kind of link all the actual movies together, you know, and everything like that. They made a sequel, and then I think they tried to make a third sequel, and that became Tales from the Dark Side or something. Oh, I should have looked this up. Yeah, I'm going by memory here and stuff, man. I loved the Creepshow movies. I've got this on VHS. I think I got the second one on VHS. I've got the DVD of this one somewhere. I still have it. Fantastic stuff. And anybody watches my channels, you know I like monkeys. And they have one of the stories, and I hope it's in the creep shows. I've watched a lot of stuff like this. But basically they had one where, you know, there's this monkey living in a box at a university or a lab or something, you know, the college and stuff. And if you got too close to the box and went in that little room, it would get you, you know. Good stuff. Creep show. All right. Now, I don't know about this one, guys. Okay, I had the comics out last night and stuff like that. But for some reason, I like this. But this is a very dated movie, okay? You watch this. It is 1989 forever, even though this thing came out in 1990. But this was really cool, man. This was Nightbreed. And Nightbreed was really cool, man. It was full of the monsters, and the monsters were the good guys, and it was the humans that were the bad guys, and just a great, great, great little movie, man. Little town of Midian. What was the guy's name in this? Boone. They kind of had a prophecy of one of the monsters that was going to come and save them, and it was Boone, you know, right there and stuff, man. But this thing is just so freaking good. But like I said, when you watch it, I'm telling you, man, 1989 forever. If you know, I love it. It's got a little cult following. They had the comic book series going. I've heard tale over the years of like a remake or something like, I don't know. But this is so freaking good. Oh, man. It's just good stuff, man. And back then in the comic books, I can find some. If you got comic books from like 89 or 90, kind of go through them because dead set in the middle of them, they had this thing that would fold out to tell you about the movie and the characters in it, man. It was like a little booklet in the middle of the comics, and you can unfold them, and each of these monsters got like a little prophecy and stuff like that. X-Men kind of pulled from this one guy here. This guy right here, here he is. These two little snakes actually live inside of him. or maybe it's one big snake. I can't remember if it was one or two, man. I always thought that was like Dr. Octopus. And then later on, they had an X-Men character named Maggot or something. And I was like, they ripped it off, you know? All right. Now we're getting, you know, we're getting into the, you know, we're getting into the more obscure stuff, you know. Exorcist was super awesome. Have you watched the TV show yet? No, no, no. I just grabbed the keep and watched it last month. Awesome. Okay, come on, come on. It's trying to upload. Horror movie live show. Took me all the way to the front. What do you think of the first Buffy movie? The first Buffy movie with Joss Whedon, I loved it, man. But it also had Paul Reubens in it. I love Paul Reubens, especially when he doesn't play Pee-wee, man. But no, I like the whole concept of the vampire hunter. And I really thought he was tapping Archie in it when I first saw it. You know, this is before we had the TV show and the legacy and stuff. I mean, I saw the first Buffy in the theater. I'm kind of mad on Nightbreed. It's a cult following, man. I definitely get what you're saying with some of this stuff. The Hellraiser stuff with the Cenobites. Only one I like of that is the second one. The second Hellraiser movie to me was genius. I thought it was fantastic. Buffy was okay. Yeah. All right. Then we get into these. I can't find them. I've got the first one here and stuff like that. Evil Dead. Now, let me tell you about the Evil Dead when it came out by Sam Raimi. They shot this like 3 or 4 hours from where I live and stuff, right? They, when they did the first Evil Dead movie and stuff, they were really, you know, using Bruce Campbell. Okay, Sam Raimi, Bruce Campbell, they would go to a bar at night. Bruce would have to pick somebody up, say, hey, man, you know, a girl, can we go to your place? And can my buddy stay on the couch and stuff? They had to hustle in ways you wouldn't believe to be able to make this movie. So when the second one came out, I was like, holy shit. Now, was I the Evil Dead fan in the house? No, my stepdad was, right? So I'd watch the movie. Never thought anything else really about it. I mean, it had its charm. I kind of got it. But when they had the second one, it was the most surreal feeling in the world for me. I'm like, somebody else knows this movie? Enough people, they made a second one? I was just sort of like, what the hell, man? Didn't know and stuff. But yeah, Evil Dead 3, and then you have Evil Dead 3, Army of Darkness. The remake was good. Love it. Even Roger Ebert gave this 3 stars and stuff, man. So fantastic. And if you watched Amazing Spider-Man 2 by Sam Raimi and stuff like that, when Dr. Octopus kind of gets his arms and stuff, he has a little bit of a Evil Dead homage in there for a few seconds, you know, stuff like that. Evil Dead is fantastic, man. Yeah, I mean, I get it. It's not, you know, groovy. Groovy. If you want to shop smart, shop S-Mart. Here's my boomstick. Whoa, man. This thing is starting. Okay, I'm looking at the comments, and it's filling in the gaps. There are a bunch of comments from way back that were not here for me a minute ago. So give me a second here. Wow. Okay, I missed a lot of comments there. Amazing. Okay, I got to see Blair Witch on a bootleg VHS before it was released or even known about it. It was one of the first viral campaigns. Fun to see it that way. Fun to see it that way, not knowing what the hell it was. Yeah, yeah. One was really good, Steve. I have episode 2. Okay, they weren't wrong. Okay, VHS rules. I saw it before they hyped. It was even weirder that way. Which DC Comics do you believe has the best writing? The VHS movies are real fun. Well, guess what? You're in for a treat. I want to talk about the VHS movies since, you know, people are sticking around. Tales from the Dark Side. I think that was with the monkey. You're probably right. Yeah. Did somebody say horror? I said horror. We all said horror. Barker. Yeah. There we go. Now I'm caught up. Yeah. I didn't watch the first Hellraiser movie until 2 months ago and I laughed. Yeah, exactly. Ash vs. Evil Dead is an awesome show. Yeah, it is, man. I forgot to keep watching it. Great story, but special effects have come a long way. A good story will make you see past the special effects. You know, seriously, you know. How many times has Ash hit his head? It's kind of like how many looks does it take to get to? Yeah. All right. How funny. Man, I'm digging this, man. These comments are awesome, man. See everybody talk about horror movies and they're pulling stuff. And I kind of like we're all on the same page. All right, now let's get to the granddaddy of what I consider the granddaddy of the modern horror and stuff. We talked about Michael Myers being that pinnacle that, you know, brought us Jason and Freddy and all this stuff, man. But what was the one that people still talk about, right? The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. All right, now we're getting into some serious shit. All right. it was really that hot in that house. Some of those scenes, the people that, you know, freaked out and everything like that were really freaking out, man. Some of the stuff, they said it was based on a true story that really scared the hell out of everybody. This thing had scenes where they were doing the shots and had such a low budget and stuff that parts of it looked like documentary and stuff. And that crazy family. And it turns out the part where they're all sitting around for dinner and the crazy dad or somebody grabs the girl, cuts her finger, sucks the blood. Turns out that was real. They didn't tell her it was coming. But you hear all kinds of stories about what happened in this movie and what didn't. And I've met people who are well-versed in this movie. They are the ones that should be doing the review on this. And I mean, they really know their shit when it comes to Leatherface and the family and all this stuff, right? And the thing about it is years ago in the military, around 96, we went to California, Nevada, Colorado, Nevada. Wait a minute, where the hell was this? Colorado, Mexican border, something like Mexican. Colorado, California border or something. We had a layover for some reason in Texas. I'm like, Texas? So we had a few hours to kill. I wanted to see a damn chainsaw in Texas. I mean, I'm young in my 20s, and I think that'd just be fucking funny, you know. Ha ha, for some reason, right? So we landed in Texas, and I walked around trying to find a chainsaw, and I'll be damned if I did. I didn't see one chainsaw, but I saw a bunch of weed eaters. And I'm like, did they lie to us? Was it the Texas Weed Eater Massacre? I'm being serious. I know how corny this sounds, but I was like, what? So it was amazing, man. But this is the one that I got to be careful when I watch. I've really got to be prepared. I've really got to be in the mood, man, because this, you know, this one's the one that gives me the tickle in the throat. This is the one that gives me the sinking feeling in the stomach if I'm not careful. This is the one where I'm like, what is wrong with me watching this? You know, this is the good shit. All right. This is not for the weak. I mean, it really is. I don't want to hype it up. I remember hearing stuff that was supposed to be awful and stuff, and I finally made it to watch it. And I'm like, it wasn't that bad. Well, this is the one where I'm like, I really felt like I needed a damn shower when this was done. Wash this shit off me. Such good stuff. All right. And then we get back to Wes Craven stuff here a little bit, okay? Yeah, we'll do a little Wes Craven. Okay, I like this movie. I have no idea if people like this movie or not, okay, because I ended up liking it. Scream. I'm not going to talk about the other Scream movies because obviously I didn't buy them, okay? But the first Scream movie, perfect. This was actually so good. Another one of those movies with a twist ending that when you go back and watch it the second time around, it's a completely different movie. This is a two-time watching movie. Maybe three, because the third time you may be looking, the second time you may be looking for the shit you missed, and then the third time you're probably watching it knowing, okay, this is what's going on. But it had a little bit of a twist in it, and this is the one that kind of made a resurgence of the horror films of this, you know, the slasher movies. That might be a better way to say it. A slasher movie, you know, kind of brought it back and stuff, and it was by Wes Craven. And what did it do? It pulled from all the other movies before it. It acknowledged this is a world where everybody was into horror movies, and there's rules in horror movies, and if you break those rules, that's how you die. And that's what this kind of, you know, shows. I mean, this was fantastic, man. It was fun. That's it. Fun. I won't say that it's a piece of fucking art. This was a fun movie. I like this Scream movie. The rest of the movies, you know, it's one of those things where you watch because it's like, well, let's see where they go with this and stuff. But no, the only one I own is this one. Really good stuff, man. Just a fun, cool movie, man. Fun, cool movie. Let's check the chat. As you can hear, I'm getting messaged at the same time. Man, I appreciate everybody hanging in there, man. Some of you guys have made it through the whole thing, man. This is fantastic. Okay. And we'll see if we can get these to refresh. I'm digging the comments, man. I kind of wish I could just kind of comment back and forth a little bit now. Okay. Hedge is like, okay, it's reloading. Come on. Craven was parodying himself. Very good. That's a great way to put it, man. Okay. Scream was a great revival of horror. All right. People like this. Scream is my favorite modern day horror. It was an original idea and a good one at that. I agree. Completely agree, man. Who, come on. Count Von Strange, comic fan. Oh, I can't see them. Okay. Have you ever seen the Craven's movie Shocker? Yes. Yeah, I kind of got into Shocker. I might have the movie poster over here somewhere or some kind of little thing. Okay, see what's going on here. All right. And since we're talking about Wes Craven, I'll just skip around here a little bit. And, okay, I've got some doubles here. Somewhere I've got these on DVD. I bought the sets where you get all four of them and stuff. But, you know, we're going to be talking about A Nightmare on Elm Street, a staple of the 90s. This is the third one. All right, but I've got six movies on VHS. Okay. Let's see if I can get the glare off there. This is the box set. I actually found this at a Goodwill, and I think I got this for like, I have to go back and look at my video, but I think I got this for like $4, $5. All right. This is a fantastic. There's no way. Whoopsie. But anyway, there was no way I was not going to get that. That was funny. I'm going to be YouTube famous now. No way I was walking away from that. I mean, that is just freaking cool, man. Okay. But Freddy, talk about, you know, being an icon of horror, if not an icon of horror just to begin with, all the way around. The thing about Freddy was, is when the first one came out, you know, it's Johnny Depp's first movie or something like that and all this stuff. And you're watching it, man. It was so cool because, you know, you didn't know what was going on. This is nightmares. This is the kind of thing where you have to go to sleep. You just have to go to sleep. You cannot fight sleep. We all have to dream and everything like that. And so Freddy was there and you find out he's like a child killer and they kind of allude that he was like a pedophile and stuff, right? So you have people like Jason and you have Freddy and Michael Myers. We're starting to get these characters, and this is kind of where I kind of saw the horror game change in the way I remember it. Now, you got to understand, I'm like 9 or 10, and it was really kind of one of the reasons I kind of shied away from horror is like sometimes it was the people that watched horror because I started seeing these people cheering for the killers. You know, that's where it was kind of changing, man. You know, it's kind of like the 90s when people started cheering for the bad guys and stuff, right? But there was nothing more disturbing for me to go out on a Halloween when I was like about 12 or 13. And I look down and I see two or three little kids within 30 minutes of them being dressed up like Freddy Krueger. They made little costumes for Freddy Krueger with the hand. And I'm sitting here like, he's a freaking pedophile, you know, in the movies. He's a pedophile. Now they got kids dressed up like, I just missed the whole point. That was one of the things where I knew it too well. And it was an event. When you went and watched a Friday the 13th movie at the theater or a Freddy into it, it was like a mini concert. Okay. It was like a mini concert in that theater. It was the first time I ever saw people jumping up, yelling, screaming, and cheering and stuff. They went a little bit overboard because I remember watching a Friday the 13th movie when Jason got stabbed in his grave and the lightning hit and he came back to life. There was a bunch of people in the front row jumping up, you know, screaming, Ozzy, Ozzy. And I'm like, oh my God, you know. Pretty bad. All right, guys, let me check the comments. I'm getting dry here. Come on. Okay, now let's see if that did it. All right. Even though the Shining Hotel was based on Stanley Hotel, the exteriors of Kubrick's Overlook were supplied by the Timberline Lodge of the Slopes of Mount Hood in Oregon. Chainsaw Massacre is still scary. TCM2 is funny as hell. Dennis Hopper. Okay, we're talking about The Shining. There we go, man. It's filling in gaps. I'm getting, every time I refresh this, I get comments you guys made a few minutes ago in between stuff I've already read. Shocker was a fun movie, and the soundtrack was excellent. You know, if you're into 80s hair metal, Paul Stanley wrote songs for other bands that was in there. And I mean, it was, let's check out the soundtrack to Wes Craven's Shocker. If you want to have a little, you know, time travel back to the 80s there and stuff like that. Oh my God, The Shocker. No More Mr. I think that was the one that had, was that No More Mr. Nice Guy by Megadeth, or was that a Child's Play? I think that was in Shocker. I don't know, man. That's badass. I actually live on Elm Street in Illinois at that. A lot of these movies kind of hit close to home. When the second one came out, it was panned. I hated it. I got the first Friday the 13th out of Goodwill for 49 cents. Well, my friend, that was the next movie we're going to talk about. Okay. Cheering for the killers. That was definitely odd, but I caught myself doing the same thing. Yeah, that's what I mean. That was how, yeah, that's kind of wild.
Mobile phone. So all you got to really do is just grab Skype on each phone. each other. Make sure that otherwise you get feedback because they're so close to each other. And just have her hold the camera.
All right, guys. Friday the 13th, right? Now, this movie was the one where I had the dread. I mean, you heard this thing was evil, and plus I lived around the woods and stuff, right? And it's got the big twist ending, and it's also like Kevin Bacon's second movie, I think, one where he actually kind of got paid a little bit more and stuff, right? Because Kevin Bacon was in Animal House. I don't know if he was anything between those two and stuff, man. But this also had a bit of a twist ending. It was kind of messed up. And this also kind of blew up the whole genre of the killer, because all of a sudden you started having psycho killers coming up. There was themes for, you know, Halloween was on Halloween. This was on Friday the 13th. There was movies where, you know, everybody was just kind of waiting to see what holiday would get its next serial killer and stuff. My Bloody Valentine. And they always had to have a household item that they could kill people with. Knives and, you know, whatever they could find and stuff. Okay. And so this first one, man, what got me, honestly, I hate to say it, but being as a kid, what got me was the fact that they were playing strip Monopoly. Not that I find it titillating, not that I was offended, just that I was like, I play Monopoly. Who thinks like, what? Don't, that's my Monopoly game. You know, I was like, play what you want, but leave my damn Monopoly out of it. You know, I mean, that's the only thing of this. And not too long ago, just a couple weeks ago, I went up to a place called Lake Shawnee. This is probably within the last 2 months. And they had a field out there, and it wasn't really a lake. It was a great big, huge, I've never been there before, but it was a great big, huge square hole in the ground. They filled up with water. But they put up the screen in the middle of the field and brought out, you had to bring a blanket or something like that. And when it got dark, they sit there and they projected it. So it's like you're at a drive through, but you're sitting on the ground. And I was sitting there looking at some of my friends or somebody there and stuff like that. And I was like, you know, if I was them, I'd have a Jason guy dressed up come out of the wood line. Well, they actually had a box beside of the screen. And all of a sudden, they act like the movie messed up. And this guy had sat in this box for like 2.5 hours just to bust out and start walking around like Jason. So this thing has a huge legacy. I actually think Friday the 13th is more popular than Halloween just because of all the movies and something about him grabbed him. But by no means would there be a Jason without a Mike Myers. That's all I'm going to say. You know, I mean, he got more and more mystical. And yes, if you watch Scream and if you've watched any of these, man, was Jason the killer in this movie or not? You know, that's the big thing. Jason actually didn't really pop up until another movie. Okay. Where are we at now? Talked about that. Okay, guys, let's switch over a little bit. You know, let's kind of switch here about something else just for a minute. Did I already talk about those? Yeah, there's a few things I left out, right? But we got some movies, right? Fell in love with these movies, okay? I'm very selective about watching anime and manga and whatever, reading that stuff like that, because it's seriously, just very few things really grab my attention, okay? I get why people are into it and all this stuff, and I can see, you know, there's people that's nuts, it's just anything comes out. I'm pretty selective. It really has to have something extra. So imagine my surprise when I ended up watching Vampire Hunter D for the first time. This is from like 1985 or 1985. And this thing is fantastic. Set in sort of an apocalyptic future. And it's full of like monsters and werewolves that are running around. And this great big huge evil Dracula is running things. Or some, I can't remember if it was actually Dracula or another kind of vampire. But all of a sudden out, you know, on, riding on his horse was his big hat. If you saw Van Helsing, the movie Van Helsing, it totally ripped off Vampire Hunter D with the hat and stuff. Vampire Hunter D is a freaking classic. You got to watch it. This movie should be on YouTube to watch for free. Okay. Fantastic movie. And I can't, when did they come out with a sequel? It was years, years, years later. A year, I think it came, thought it came out. But we had Vampire Hunter D Bloodlust, the sequel. And it was so good to see him back and stuff. Man, this is just fantastic. Such good, good cartoon. All right. See if anybody knows some Vampire Hunter D. We're going to wrap it up here in a few minutes, guys. I'm running dry here, man. I've had a blast. But I got a few more movies we'll go over. And I appreciate everybody sticking around, man. This has been fun. Okay. All right. Oh, no. The chat has disappeared. What happened? Oh no. Unreal. But I'm back. I think. Fuck no. Thank you, YouTube. You guys are fantastic. So I appreciate you with the opportunity to be on this chat show, but you have to piss me off. Okay, let's go to history. See if I can get it to come up in history. I got a notification. All right. Give me my chat back. Found it. I am back with you guys. I've missed you. I really missed you. Oh, I got some thumbs ups. Okay. All the way back. Let's see where we're at. Some people are checking out. Appreciate it, guys. Oh, man, there's a bunch of more comments that are just now coming through in between ones I've already read, man. It's all right. I'm not going to say or complain. It has been fun. I hope you guys have had a good time out there. No more Mr. Nice Guy was in Shocker. Yes, I knew it, man. Does Arbor Day have a serial killer movie? No, but I think we could do it. I think we have found our hook, man, okay? I will help with this comic there, Jared. We will do that. We'll push it as a movie, you know, Arbor Day killer, you know. Save the tree. The trees make him do it. I saw that at the drive-in. That's funny. Leprechaun was a hilarious good time in horror. Sorry, guys. I have not touched Leprechaun, man. If you like it, good for you. Was it Warwick Davis? That was the Leprechaun? Oh, my God, man. That movie. I'm glad you guys like it, though. We shall not have a division between us. I hated Friday the 13th. I wish I could see who this is. Ugh. Somebody Media. Infrared Media. Yeah, yeah. I hated Friday the 13th. You run, Jason walks, he trips, fall down, break your leg, and he kills you. I preferred Freddy's personality. When I went and saw Freddy versus Jason in the theater, I went on a Monday night. I had a kid. I was married. I worked during the day. And the only time I could really go to where I wanted to sit down and enjoy this movie and not have anybody talking around me or have bring their freaking kids and stuff like that is I picked a Monday at 10 o'clock. Nobody went to the theater on a Monday at 10 o'clock in this little town. So they turned around and I got in there and it was the most bizarre thing. The theater was full in this small town and I didn't recognize these people. Monday night at 10 o'clock, maybe it had been 10:30. So I get in there and I just happened to sit down and I don't know how this happened. Maybe everybody was just playing along. I don't know, man. But in the side of the theater I was on, everybody cheered for Jason. On the other side of the theater, everybody cheered for Freddy. Yeah, Freddy, man. So every time one made a kill, this side of the theater, yeah. Every time Jason made a kill, Freddy made a kill over there, yeah, and all this stuff. And if you've seen Freddy versus Jason, they turned around and there's a part where Jason comes out of a cornfield on these two guys drinking moonshine at a party. There's only these guys. Well, the one guy throws the moonshine on him, lights it up, and you know you're way back in the mountains when you have three or four people in that theater going, hell, that ain't good moonshine. That shit's supposed to burn blue, which is you're supposed to have a blue flame to know that the moonshine was good. And I'm like, I was like, oh my God, even the rednecks are critiquing the movie, man. It was so funny. Full Metal Alchemist, Attack on Titan, crazy. I talked about that a few minutes ago, I think. Love Attack on Titan. It was Davis, Wicked Woods Leprechaun. Yeah, nice, man. Yeah, I'm not touching them. I'm not doing it, man. They put him in space, man. I was like, oh, my God. All right, see what we got here. You know, I'm going to save the Universal stuff for later. See what we have. What do we have? Okay, good vampire movie, 30 Days of Nights, based on some comics. Very good stuff. Really good movie. Alaskan town where it turns dark for 6 months at a time. Vampires are like, what didn't we think of this before? We never have to get out of the sun. We got 6 months just to walk around. What happens? You know, little town folks hanging out. It's got a little touch of Anne Frank in it, to tell you the truth. I always kind of wondered if this was kind of like making a statement about, you know, World War II a little bit, you know, maybe. I don't know, man. All right. And let's end this. I know, man, we've talked about some hardcore horror stuff, man, but let's talk about some of the fun stuff, you know, all right? Rocky Horror Picture Show. What can I say? You've been doing Rocky for 1993, 23 years and stuff. And usually I always go as Riff Raff. I've been to Transylvania twice, but I usually go as Riff Raff, and I've been as Eddie a few times. some costumes were better than others during the year and stuff like that, but just a lot of fun, man. A little cult movie that's just fantastic. And it's really a lot of fun, man. First time I ever went, I was like, where the hell have you brought me? You know? And then one of those things that, I'm squashing something. One of those things that, it's become a tradition and I always try to have to watch it. And I collect the comics that come out once a year and stuff, man. Simpsons Treehouse of Horror. Usually three stories with each one, and you can always kind of see where they're harkening back to what. So much fun, and it's a holiday tradition with me now, okay? I would love I'd be fine just having all the Treehouse of Horrors, and that's it, you know. Such good stuff, man. This is Treehouse of Horror 3 and Treehouse of Horror 5 for some reason. Yeah, but I think this was a set of 3 or 4 VHS tapes and stuff, man. These are so freaking good, right? And then I need to check this out. If you're a fan of the, let me get the name right. I've been doing this for a while. I can feel the effects. But anyway, Baskin Robbins, that's a freaking ice cream, man. Oh my God. Rankin and Bass. If you grew up watching the stop animation of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, well, people, they got Boris Karloff and they did a Mad Monster Party special that came on TV. And I freaking dig this, man. It's got it looks like Anne Margaret. You got Boris Karloff. You got some skeletons dressed up like the Beatles, where as I got older, I'm like, that's the Ramones, just, being silly and stuff. It's got all the great monsters in it and stuff. It's just fun. And let's face it, I'm in this with something completely different. Let me check the chat and I'll show you the last one. And I have no shame about it. I have no shame. It's my live show. And come on. Here we go. Again, I'm starting to see comments that I've already went past and it's filling in the gaps here, man. So let me get caught up. Love the concept of 30 days and nights. Great. Got to go. See you later. It's great show. Oh, thanks, man. Okay. Dude, I'm old. I'm with you. I saw it when it came out. Wow, I never saw that. The Conjuring 2 is a scary dang movie. I've watched a movie through my fingers. I haven't watched a movie through my fingers since The Exorcist. I've actually made it halfway through that. I've already found it online to watch. So it sounds like I need to keep going. And That Nun. Okay, that must be talking about that movie. All right. So, guys, to end this fantastic chat, for all you guys that hung in there, and a lot of you guys dropped out as soon as I said we're leaving and ending in a minute. But, you might have already know what this is, man, but let's face it. There is a tradition for me, at least for Christmas also, and for Halloween. It's from the same people, if you will, and stuff like that. But, it doesn't really feel like Halloween. And even with Christmas, it doesn't feel like Christmas unless I see these specials from these guys, okay? And, of course, I'm talking about it's the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown. Yes. This is a classic. This is just a classic. You have to watch it every year. Oh, so good. Did she waste her Halloween waiting for the Great Pumpkin with Linus? Did she? All because she loved the boy? Did Charlie Brown ever get candy? Did Snoopy ever, become the life of the party? Oh, yeah. It's the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown. We've gone from Texas Chainsaw Massacre to Charlie Brown. It's all the same game. All right, guys, let me check the chat one more time. I got more stuff to show, but maybe, in a couple of weeks, I'll do another little Halloween video. Oh, man. This is awesome. God, you guys are fantastic in these. In this, I hope I get to get off here just in time to load up and read the complete chat here, man. This thing is fantastic. Wow. Okay. Come on. Insidious was good. Classic. My wife and I watched it. May your pumpkin patch be the most sincere. Thank you, sir. J Horror. May your pumpkin patch also be the most sincere there, Jared. Appreciate it, guys. All right, guys. Thanks a lot. That was a lot of fun. I need to drink. I'm going to get a cigarette. I'm still hungry. So, and I'm going to have to watch some movies now. I'm kind of in the mood. Later, guys. Happy freaking Halloween.